Hi, I'm Tim Berglund with Confluent, and I'd like to talk to you about the relationship between KSQL and Kafka itself. Now, I'm going to assume, for purposes of this video, that you already know something about Kafka. You're interested in knowing about KSQL and really how it fits in and how the two things relate. So, let's back up a step and think, what's the most basic way that a Kafka client can communicate with a Kafka broker or a Kafka cluster? And that is producers and consumers. If you put messages into a topic, you're a producer. If you get messages out of a topic, you're a consumer. Those are well-documented wire protocols. There's language bindings for every language under the sun to get that done in the language of your choice. And so there you go. Anything at the end of the day that's putting messages in, taking messages out, is a producer or a consumer. And frankly, under the covers, KSQL is no exception. There's got to be producers and consumers down there. But because that gets a little old for doing sophisticated stream processing, just doing everything a message at a time, we also have the Kafka Streams API. This does stream processing on Kafka topic data. When I say stream processing, I mean rather than put a message in, get a message out, do things with the message, it's more a way of saying in a functional way, hey, for every message in this stream, filter it based on this logic, or transform it based on this function, or something like that. Or, you know, more sophisticated things like count the things that are grouped by this key. All that kind of stuff is doable in kind of a one-liner way in the Kafka Streams API. Of course, the Kafka Streams API is a Java-only API as of the time of this recording. So if you're programming in Java, that's fine, but it's also fairly complex. Sometimes it's the thing you need. It's a tool you need in your tool chest, but we would rather have something simpler if we can get away with it. And that is where KSQL comes in. So Streams is built on top of the producer and the consumer. KSQL is built on top of Kafka Streams. So the KSQL engine, this thing that we're gonna throw our queries at and it's gonna process them for us, it really is a Kafka Streams API under the covers. So if you need to be able to think about how KSQL works in relationship to a Kafka cluster, you can think of it as this very helpful pre-baked Kafka Streams app that's been written for you. And these things kind of go on a continuum. This sort of trade-off is probably familiar if you've been building systems for any length of time. On the one hand, we have extreme flexibility. That's the producer and the consumer. You can literally do anything. The problem is, on that end of the scale, you might have to do almost everything. They don't do much for you. So sophisticated, say, stateful grouping and aggregation operations require you to solve a lot of problems, and you're probably not in the business of building that kind of infrastructure. So we move towards the simpler end of the scale. We've got Kafka Streams, which is a complex API in its own right, a complex Java API that now you have to learn, and it's appropriate to learn in many cases, but it takes away some of the thorny distributed systems problems that you would have had to solve by yourself doing everything in your own consumers. So Streams makes your life easier by solving the state problem and solving the high-level stream processing problem for you. Becoming even more simple up the stack is KSQL. It's a SQL-like language. You write a query that describes what you want the system to do, and that system goes off and runs the query for you. So it's by far the easiest one of these things to do, to learn and use. But of course, we make trade-offs in flexibility as we move up the scale. Streams, you know, does stream processing. There might be some basic produce and consume things that would be a little cumbersome with the Streams API. And of course, KSQL, naturally, if it's SQL-like, is going to be much easier to use than a Java API. What are these streams that we're talking about? Well, they're Kafka topics. When you run a KSQL query, the data is always coming from a Kafka topic. The data in that topic could be Avro, could be JSON, could be comma delimited. There's even a comma delimited option. So there's some option for schema there, and that's a great thing. And also, when we're creating new streams with a KSQL query, those will automatically get written back into a Kafka topic. So we read data from Kafka topics, we write data into Kafka topics. We're just doing it in this very simple, declarative, SQL-like way. But if you're a person who understands Kafka well, I want to make sure that you don't see any magic going on here. We're just getting stuff out of topics, doing things to it, putting it back into new topics in an efficient and high productivity way with a SQL-like language. So is KSQL just like SQL? Well, I wouldn't really want to say that in front of anyone. It has very familiar syntax, some familiar semantics, but it's for fundamentally for queries on continuous streaming data, not relational tables. So even though it can do some relational things, it can do joins, it can do other operations that are familiar from SQL, it's similar but different, and those differences are important. Does KSQL depend on Kafka? Absolutely, yes. KSQL is for doing stream processing on data stored in a Kafka cluster. So it is fundamentally a Kafka client, so you gotta have a Kafka there for it to work. KSQL, again, does write topic data. It has embedded producers in it. So when we create new streams or new tables, those get emitted into new Kafka topics. And those are just Kafka topics like anything else. So if you have some non-KSQL application that needs to get at that, like maybe you use Kafka Connect to write a result out into Elasticsearch or a relational database or something like that, do it all day long. It's just a topic. Does it read topic data? Again, yes, embedded consumers in KSQL. So if you've got data coming from somewhere that's not a KSQL application, again, maybe Kafka Connect pulling in mainframe data or something like that, or something from some custom IoT network or some such, that's fine. Get it into a topic in Kafka and then KSQL can see it. So it fully integrates with Kafka topics on both ends. In between, of course, it now functions as this abstraction over the Kafka Streams API that enriches data and does various kinds of cool processing that we'll look at in other videos on the data in between the source and the destination. So that's a quick overview of KSQL for the Kafka-minded. If you want to know how it plugs into the Kafka you already know and love, hopefully you've got a basic picture of that. And I hope you can dive into some of our other videos that explore KSQL in more detail.